It's impossible for me to stand here this morning without thinking back to the day more than 20 years ago when President Rick Warsh first asked me to read opening words at a Lawrence convocation. Now, even as we mourn his passing, we also celebrate and look forward to the tenure of a new Lawrence president. And so today, these opening words, which are taken from the works of the American poet Muriel Rukeyser. Nourish beginnings. Let us nourish beginnings. Not all things are blessed, but the seeds of all things are blessed. The blessing is in the seed. This moment, this seed, this wave of the sea, this look, this instant of love. Years over wars and an imagining of peace, or the expiation journey toward peace, which is many wishes flaming together. Fierce, pure life, the many living home. Love that gives us ourselves in the world known to all. New techniques for the healing of the wound and the unknown world. One life or the faring stars.
Good morning. My name is Philip Swan. I am honored to serve as the chair of the Committee on Public Occasions, and it's my privilege to welcome you today to the first convocation for the 2013-2014 academic year. Please bear with us as we do a mini set change and prepare for the new student choir in just a moment. We have an exciting lineup for this year's convocations. Before I introduce the series, I must thank last year's committee for their efforts in compiling the slate of speakers for this year's series. Matt Ansfield, Mark Phelan, Steve Seek, Ben Reinhardt, John Shimon, Julie Lindemann, Jamie Cartwright, and Cal Hoosman really need to be thanked, especially for their work in putting this series together. I would especially like to thank, go ahead. I would especially like to thank an unsung hero who works tirelessly to pull together all of the background details for these events. Please join me in thanking Linda Peters, coordinator for events and summer programs, for her help in coordinating these special events. I'd like to briefly introduce the series. Today we are excited to hear from our new president, Mark Burstein, as he shares his thoughts on new beginnings and his vision for community. On Tuesday, October 15th, 2013, our guest will be author and cartoonist Allison Bechdel. Her work is familiar to our student body and faculty since her book, Fun Home, has been part of the Freshman Studies course since 2010. Her talk is entitled Drawing Lessons, The Comics of Everyday Life. During winter term, on Thursday, January 23rd, 2014, our special guest speaker will be Morgan Spurlock. A filmmaker, humorist, and political activist, Spurlock is best known for his documentary film, Supersize Me, and his documentary television series on FX. And for our honors convocation day, Thursday, May 29th, 2014, our own Kathy Kautsky, professor of music and piano department chair, will be sharing her thoughts on an insider's view of what really goes on in the conservatory. I encourage you to mark your calendars and plan to attend each event in the convocation series. Now, please look at your not-so-smart mobile devices and find that special switch and turn it off. Thank you. And now the new student choir.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Isn't this wonderful to have such beautiful music for each of our convocations? Let's hear it again for this group. This morning, I have the great honor and privilege to introduce Lawrence University's 16th president, who will today be giving his first matriculation convocation address. All those who have met Mark Burstein have been impressed by his intelligence, his friendliness, his energy, and his willingness to listen carefully and make decisions thoughtfully. Mark Burstein is a graduate of Vassar College, where he clearly learned about the value of a liberal education in a residential setting with a high-quality faculty devoted to teaching. Mark is now a member of Vassar's Board of Trustees. With his move to Sampson House, we expect that Vassar will be trying to borrow ideas from us. And furthermore, will be inclined to see themselves as the Lawrence of the East. Mark has earned a master's degree in business administration from the University of Pennsylvania's highly respected Wharton School. It is there that he developed his high level of skill in financial management, a skill that will serve Lawrence well. Mark has held high-level positions at Columbia University and Princeton University, where he has been involved in several important projects. While at Columbia, he started the process of acquiring land in the heart of New York City and using it to create an important new extension to Columbia's existing campus. Creating campus space in the middle of one of the most densely populated cities in the world required a great deal of skill. This academic project represents a remarkable transformation. So, when Mark speaks of the transformative nature of higher education, he knows what he's talking about. There has been a tradition of the Ivy Leagues taking talent from quality liberal learning institutions such as Lawrence. It is wonderful to bask in the knowledge that it is Lawrence that has stolen high-quality talent from the Ivy League. On a personal note, in the short time I've known him, I have found Mark to be a remarkable leader. It is hard to keep up with him, either in terms of psychic energy or intellect. He is a very thoughtful and outgoing person and is able to make clear, positive decisions. His focus on the importance of community is very powerful. It is that focus, the importance of community, that forms the basis of his remarks today. Please join me in welcoming Mark Burstein.
Dave, thank you so much for that very generous introduction. It is a wonderful tradition to start the matriculation convocation hearing the new voices of our community. So just want to echo what Dave said, just a pleasure. It is a pleasure to be here with you today. The beginning of the academic year always brings a sense of hope for what we can accomplish together, and a sense of expectation that our learning this year will transform us and the college. In recognition of Rick Warsh's death on Saturday, we will start today with his voice, one familiar in this chapel. Our 14th president believed that the collegiate model of higher education transcends the curriculum and the academic program of the institution. Among the attributes that make the liberal arts college distinctive are those that emanate from the fact that it enrolls a predominantly traditional undergraduate student population, that it is of a size that makes its claim to community realizable, if not always realized, that it is in the main residential and coeducational, and that it intends the student undergraduate experience to be whole rather than bifurcated into curricular and extracurricular segments. Further, the liberal arts college seeks not only to prepare students for lives of career and work, but also to equip them to develop as private persons and public agents. Close quotes. Thus, for the community we create is part of our curriculum. Rick's quotations raise at least three important questions for us. Have we realized true community here at Lawrence? What are the challenges we face as the concept of a traditional undergraduate population is in a state of nearly constant revision? And what would it mean for us to more adequately prepare our students to be public agents? I begin this talk knowing the limits of my analysis. I have been with you for less than 3 months, and I'm still learning Lawrence, its history, traditions, and community. On the other hand, fresh eyes can sometimes provide new insights about who we are and what challenges we face. The move to Appleton this past summer provided many, many opportunities to accumulate knowledge and encounter new experiences. For example, the first time someone told me to park in the ramp, I thought, why not park in the spaces on the level floors? And then I realized that here, ramp meant the entire parking garage. And of course, there is our love of intersections with four-way stop signs. We hardly ever have them in New York. There, only loud arguments could decide who got to the stop sign first. I actually had to look up the driving instructions to figure out how to navigate these intersections. I'm also artfully trying to use new idioms, like a horse apiece, in common conversation. For example, in Andrew Commons, the distance between the salad bar and the grill station is now a horse apiece to me. Did I use that right so far? And after 11 weeks here, I almost have the nerve to wear my Packers jersey, given to me. Oh, well. Given to me by the president of Princeton, which includes my last name and my Princeton honorary class numbers. I am sure everyone will believe that number 83 on the Packers has the last name Burstein. I did check, there's no 83 on the Packers, so I'm safe. Being here has given me an opportunity to see how gracious, welcoming, and supportive we can be to newcomers. Members of the Lawrence and Appleton communities have gone out of their way to explain the area's traditions, unwritten rules, and language. This process of accumulating membership has given me ample opportunity to cross the threshold into Lawrence, like many of the new students in the chapel today, and also to consider the state of our community. My move to Appleton has also led me to rethink what community means in our time. Social, economic, and technological changes in the last 50 years have changed communities. the common characteristics around which communities were organized. Some might call them superficial characteristics, such as gender, race, or place of origin, have been transcended by a new understanding of commonality, defined in part by a sense of shared purpose. In these new social structures, individuals who may be very different from one another decide to participate. Eliot Deutsch describes this new version of community in the following way. We have said that a person participates in communities. It requires a certain openness and sensitivity, a willingness to contribute to the evoking of a spatial atmosphere or presence, which becomes the basis for further personal involvement. Participation is a mode of being together with others in such a way that something entirely new is engendered. Deutsch's definition of community clearly fits institutions like Lawrence. We are a voluntary community, formed more by active participation than by common beliefs, geography, or origins. But have we created what he calls a special atmosphere or presence through our participation? In part, we have. As Rick stated in many of his writings, we believe education takes place through our residential community. Learning is transmitted from faculty to students directly, and also in classroom dialogue, in residence halls, in the Warsh Center, and in the Mudd Library. The playing fields, campus activities, and community services also provide ways to better understand ourselves and the liberal arts and conservatory curriculum. This learning community is carefully tended by faculty, by staff, and nurtured by all Laurentians. We have much to be proud of. Our social norm to have students from different classes live together in residence halls and to eat together at one location has created a strong, distinctive campus cohesion. Almost every day, I am struck by this unified identity. This sense of Lawrence as a coherent whole permeates faculty and staff. As I met with colleagues this summer, common themes, hopes, and aspirations clearly outweighed individual or disciplinary concerns. Yes, we have the physical divides of College Avenue and the Fox River. We have pedagogical differences between the conservatory and the liberal arts and sciences departments. We have different agendas for administrative units. But the shared sense of Lawrence is palpable. It is one of our clearest strengths. This interconnected community of ideas, hopes, and support is unique in my experience, and an aspect of this college we should nurture whenever we can. To be fair, there is one topic of disagreement I found in conversation with academic departments and programs and students. Can you folks guess what that is? It is our academic calendar. Our trimester system is not universally loved. I've heard many conflicting suggestions of how we can improve the situation. For example, someone suggested we should consider having classes on the weekends, which I am sure all the assembled would support wholeheartedly. Right? This response has confirmed for me that this is a topic I should avoid for at least a couple of years. I hear assent in the avoidance, so I'm good with that. Nevertheless, I believe we can, we need to, build on our strengths as a cohesive community. Our own students tell us why. Data from the Student Climate Survey, which was administered by the President's Committee on Diversity Affairs in 2007, 8, 11, and 13, underline areas for improvement. Between 84 and 96% of the respondents over that four-year period said they felt comfortable, accepted, and safe on campus, and intellectually stimulated. This is a stunningly good appraisal of our community. But some areas raise concerns. For example, a surprisingly high percentage of students whose religious faith is an important part of their identity said they experience discrimination on campus. These concerns were also voiced in the comments collected annually. For example, one student wrote last year on the survey, "People seem pretty dismissive of the opinions of those with religious beliefs. I don't feel comfortable talking about my religion here." Another stated, "I feel that as a Christian and as a practicing Catholic in particular, I am looked down upon here at Lawrence University because it is overall a largely secular institution. Many students view my religion as a joke, and the culture in general is not at all accepting of Catholics, unless I am with a group of people who are Christian as well." This is one of many similar issues raised by students of different groups. The tone of these comments repeat itself in the sample and underscores the complexity of a community that is created through participation rather than centered around common characteristics. A community in which difference rather than similarity is the rule. I hope we can use this information, which will be disseminated by the President's Advisory Committee on Diversity Affairs, to frame a campus conversation in which we can, paraphrasing Deutsch, participate openly and sensitively. This dialogue will not only strengthen Lawrence, it will also provide an opportunity for us all to learn from one another. We also need to make sure that social cohesion does not prevent us from offering opportunities to learn from others with radically different opinions. When I think back to my college education, I remember a guest lecturer in my German history course who argued that the Holocaust was overblown and needed to be put back into the historic arc of European history. Other students and I tried to mount opposing arguments after the lecture, but the speaker had a much better grasp on the period than we did. The lecture motivated me to study that point of history and form my own opinions, rather than accept either the view of the historian or the prevailing societal view. I used this example on the Princeton campus when LGBTQ students asked me how I could be a senior member of the administration and allow a tenured faculty member to provide the intellectual and philosophical inspiration for the No on Marriage organization, the largest organization in the United States fighting same-sex marriage. I believed that as long as he supported alternative views in the classroom, this faculty member provided an opportunity for students to research and better understand their own views. In the end, discussions with this faculty member did not make me change my own decision to marry, but it did make me think through my motivations, their legitimacy, and the societal impact of my decision. I have heard criticism from a number of Laurentians who believe we do not provide enough opportunities for students to hear opposing views. They believe we stick to our normative arguments. Certainly, many of us have similar views on a number of issues, and it is unclear whether we invite speakers and scholars to provide alternative perspectives. If we truly intend to prepare students to be public agents in a complex world, and to prepare students to work with people very different from themselves, then we must provide access to the diversity of opinions that exist in the world today. A student last spring encapsulated for me another strength of our community. He called it humbleness. In a conversation about what kept him at Lawrence, he described in rather moving terms this college as a place where students rarely compete with each other, except on the playing field. Deutsch addresses the same topic in slightly different terms. When describing how participants approach their role in communities, he states, "There is a peculiarity in this vulnerability, this exposure of personhood, which is that real openness as distinct from superficial good fellowship, comes from a strength of spirit, that special non-egocentricity which transcends potentially destructive egocentrism." Coming from an East Coast Ivy League environment, I have seen how egotistic competitiveness can hamper learning and community connection. I'm very interested to see how education is different when intense competition is absent from the classroom. I agree with Deutsch that egotism, the practice of talking and thinking about oneself excessively because of an undue self-importance, inhibits learning and intellectual exchange. As the student I spoke with last spring said, this special aspect of our community is a prerequisite for our unique intellectual discourse and for fostering the community we have made here. Rick understood and described this special and important feature of intellectual discourse at Lawrence. He stated, "By intellectual community, I mean a place where ideas are taken seriously and where a common curiosity and a spirited exchange about ideas of importance and influence are central and significant. Such a community is not a place where each individual only does his or her intellectual thing apart from and hence uninterested in others, but where we have conversations across disciplines, beyond disciplines, and where we understand the life of the mind to be an experience of pleasure and of purpose. It is a place, in short, where individual intellectual competencies flourish, to be sure, but where communal intellectual concerns thrive as well." Through my conversations this summer, I have asked many of you, how can we better support communal intellectual concerns? I wholeheartedly agree with Rick that pursuit of knowledge, irrespective of discipline boundaries, is essential to an intellectual community we strive to be. I believe our humble approach to learning makes us uniquely prepared for this goal. In one of my last conversations with Rick, we discussed the need to both celebrate who we are and motivate Lawrence forward. The strength of the community we have created gives us much to celebrate. It also provides unique opportunities for students and the rest of us to learn and grow. But we can certainly enhance what so many have worked to build, the special atmosphere, as Deutsch so compellingly described. I believe we are up for this challenge, and I look forward to joining you in this endeavor. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.